video. I don't know that you know this, but behind the scenes, there's always a group of people that make everything. If you can see us or hear us, or if it's creative, these are the ones that I said, can I put y'all's picture up there? And so let me show you a picture. They're right behind the wall right now. They're the ones that are making everything work. And the happy guy with the thumb up, that's Ben Cruz. He's the one that made that video last night. So pretty cool. Very creative people around here, and they're a blessing to work with. I'm Robert Emmett. I'm one of the pastors here at CBC. If you were here last week, then you know I'm talking about fear this week. If you're here for the first time, fear not. That's the message, fear not. 400 times God tells us not to be afraid. And wherever you are in the world, online, I know a lot of our countries that are watching, you got to be kind of a secret saint, because to be public, it would mean a lot of trouble for you. And so you'll be particularly interested in this. But everybody goes through fear. In fact, right now, if you have ever been afraid of anything at any time in your life, raise your hand. All right? Now, I'm going to give you, God says 400 times, fear not, so many different ways. Jesus comes along, and a bunch of times he says, don't worry about today. Don't worry about food, shelter, and clothing. Fear not. He's walking on the water to his disciples. They're in a storm fighting for their lives. He walks out on the water, and they see him, and they're scared to death, and he says, fear not. It's a reality of human life that you and I are going to be afraid of things in our lives. It goes with it. Afraid of being alone, afraid of being in the dark, afraid of being rejected, afraid of death, afraid of public speaking. There's a zillion fears out there. What I'm going to give you today, first off, are five verses of the 400 that I have really enjoyed, and I've gotten them over the years. So if you got children, teach these to your children. All it takes is one or two to remind us that God of the universe never leaves us nor forsakes us. So these are five verses. I learned them over time, Sunday school and that. First one, when I am afraid, I will trust in God, Psalms 56:3. I learned that as a kid in Sunday school, but I learned the King James English. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. So every time I walked into a dark room or took the trash out late at night and got scared, I was just, what time am I afraid? I'll trust in thee. What time am I afraid? I'll trust in thee. And nothing bad happened to me. The second one is, same chapter, I trust in God, so why should I be afraid? That's kind of the first class version of the other verse. Jesus said, he is with me always, even unto the ends of the age. This one got into my head as a little kid. When I went to bed, I used to leave half of the bed for Jesus, since he was with me, and I gave him the good side of the pillow. You know, there's a bad side of the pillow that flaps, and you got the zipper and all that. Well, I would give Jesus the good side, and I'd sleep on the bad side, because, I mean, man, he's Jesus. I wanted him to be comfortable while we slept. But anyway, that's a kid. That's a concrete thinking. Don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Paul says that. And he finishes that verse with, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. And then Paul also finishes in that chapter, I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. If your children are afraid, teach them one or two of these verses and just tell them, remember, the Lord is with you always. Remember that, quote the verses, and I promise you, you'll find God's strength there. My first really awareness of fear, I was a little kid, I guess preschool, 4 or 5 years out, I don't know, but I roomed with my brother. We were roommates until I was 7th grade. We had twin beds. And I don't remember the age, but I remember going to bed and trying to go to sleep and getting scared to death by the sound of footprints in the leaves outside the window. And I thought somebody was outside, but I heard this. And a couple of times, my brother's name was Harry, and I said, Harry, do you hear that? Hear what? Somebody's walking outside the window. No, they're not. Yeah, they are. I hear them. I don't hear anything. Just shut up and go to bed, Butch. That was my nickname, Butch. It was my big brother. He's 3 years older than me. So, you know, if you're a little brother, you know what that feels like, right? We get the bed next to the wall. They get the good bed. We get the bad mattress. They get the good one. But anyway, I discovered when I got scared, I would roll over on my right side where I could see my brother right across the way. And I noticed when I laid on my right side facing him, the footsteps went away. And so every night while we were growing up, I always went to bed, laid on my right side, said goodnight to him, and just kept my eye on him because he was my big brother, and I knew he could beat anybody up that would come in that room. But I had peace. Fear was overcome. I would find out many years later that the sound of those silent footsteps was my heart beating in the mattress when I laid to sleep on my stomach. And you could hear your heart. You say, nobody explained that to you? No. I mean, did you explain it to your four-year-old? Now, when you sleep on your stomach, you're going to hear footsteps. Relax. Robert hears them too. Now, I'm going to teach you how to overcome fear. Very simple. First one is learn everything you can. Let me hear you say, learn everything I can. The second part of overcoming fear is act on what you learn. Let me hear you say, act on what I learn. And the third one is press on. One more time, learn everything I can, act on what I learn, press on. And let me give you some scenarios, a lot of different ways of fear. But the first scenario is in Genesis chapter 12. And it's whenever you find yourself moving someplace new. You college students going off to college for the first time, and you're scared to death about going, checking into the dorm or the apartment, whatever. What's that going to be like? You get scared. That's logical. That's reasonable. That's human. Maybe you're in business and you're getting transferred. Maybe your family's getting transferred. Maybe you've been here all your life in San Antonio, but whatever business you did is kind of dried up, but it's really flourishing in some other state. And so you got to debate, do I go there where the work is, or do I stay here and struggle? Maybe you make that decision, we're going to go to the new place. And when you tell your family we're moving, especially with little kids, oh, what's it going to be like? And you just get all nervous and worked up. This first couple is named Abraham and Sarah. You know them because they're the founders of the Jewish nation. And God tells them 3,000 years ago, 3,500 years, maybe 4,000, but he tells them to leave the land of Haran and go to the land of Canaan, which you and I now know is the Holy Lands, the Promised Land, Israel. So it's like a 500-mile journey across the wilderness. And back then, when you had to make a move, you didn't call North American Van Lines and say, hey, we're moving from Haran to Canaan. What's that going to cost us? You didn't move. You stayed where you were. You were born there. You lived there. You died there. The only time you moved was when there was famine in the land and you were starving to death and had to go someplace else, or when enemies came in and drove you out. But moving back then was unheard of. And yet the Lord tells Abraham, I want you to leave. Look at verse 1. He spells it out. The Lord said, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation, into a great nation, which was a big deal because Abraham was 75 and didn't have any children. He said, I will bless you. I will make you famous. You will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you. God said, go to a new place. It's scary, I know, but I'm going to bless you, make you famous. It's going to work. Trust me. And at that point, Abraham could say, you know what? I don't know anybody in Canaan, but look at the next verse, verse 4. It says, Abraham departed as the Lord had instructed, and Lot went with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he left Haran. Now go down to verse 7. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham. He's in the land of Canaan. The Lord appeared to him, and he said, I will give you this land to be your descendants and to your descendants. And Abraham built an altar there, and he dedicated it to the Lord who had appeared to him. He tells him to go. Once he goes and gets there, now the Lord, pre-incarnate Christ, whenever you see capital L-O-R-D, and they're appearing to somebody, that's Jesus on earth. Now, you know, there's angels and others, but when you see that, you know it's Jesus on earth, visibly seen and talking to Abraham. And because he went and did as God said, overcame his fears, learned all he could, he acted on what he learned, and he pressed on, and he gets there, and Jesus appears to him and says, great job. This land is going to be your land. When you get afraid to go someplace, you remember that. You remember Abraham and Sarah. Wherever you're moving, you military people, y'all are old pros at moving around a lot. But for a lot of you, this home is your place, and there's going to be that day where an opportunity to go someplace else is there. You're going to get so nervous and afraid. Go back to Genesis 12 and go, ah, the Lord appeared to them. He will appear to us. And when he did, Abraham built an altar and worshiped. So wherever you go, first Sunday you're there, go to church. Second Sunday you're there, go to church. In fact, why don't you just go to church every week, wherever you go. If it's a small church, may not be the same church every week, but wherever you go in the land, you say to your family, look, we're going to church this weekend. We don't know anybody. Nope, but we know Jesus, and he's going to be there. Now, the second one is whenever you face a really stressful meeting that you know is going to go bad. Has anybody here, other than myself, ever had one of those confrontations, those meetings? You dread it. You just play it over in your head. It can go a thousand ways, and every way seems to be bad. If that's you, raise your hand. Okay. Your man is in Genesis chapter 33. And you can read the whole story, but it's Jacob. He got run off from his own hometown, but he got run off for good reason. He stole Esau, his older brother's birthright. Everything was going to Esau because he was the older brother. Jacob, who was a clever guy, he tricks his older brother, who was a warrior, killer, hunter, gatherer, tricks him out of his birthright. When Esau realizes it, he gets furious and he says, I'm going to kill him. And he wasn't speaking metaphorically. He said, I am going to kill him. Word, the mother told Jacob. Jacob left. He gets married. He has kids. Everything's going fine. And then the Lord says, you know what? You got to go back to the promised land. But Esau's there. The last thing Esau said is, I'm going to kill him. And so for 20 years, he lives with his dread of this confrontation meeting. And finally, in chapter 33, he goes back, and he's got all of his family, and everything's there, but he's got to face Esau. Verse 1, they meet, and here comes Esau with 400 of his men. That's not a good sign. And so Jacob, of this, how would you like to work for Jacob? So Jacob divided the children among Leah, Rachel, and his two servant wives. He put the servant wives and their children at the front. How you like that? Hey, what do you mean? Yep, sorry, y'all are at the front. Then he put Leah, the wife that he didn't really like but kind of got stuck with because he married Rachel. So he puts her and her kids next, and then he puts Rachel, the woman he truly loved, and Joseph at the very back. So he's getting everything set, but he's in the front, so he's just laying out his priorities. He goes to Esau, and Esau's coming with 400 guys. Jacob is scared to death. He's been dreading this for 20 years, and now it looks like this is it. This is the end of life. But God said, go back, and so he does. He sees his brother, and he bows down 7 times, hoping to just kind of, that's kind of like you and I going, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. And Esau runs up and just grabs him, shakes him, gives him a bear hug. They both start crying. And Esau says, hello, brother. How are you doing? Are these your wives and your kids? This is incredible. And Jacob's just scared to death. You know what? And he says, I've got sheep and goats and cattle, and you can have it. I've got lots of stuff to give you. And Esau says, oh, no, I don't need it. I'm doing fine. You keep it. Now, tell me who your kids are and your wives. This is awesome. You got to come to the house and celebrate. And this was a 20-year dread, and all of a sudden, in an instant, God made it turn out entirely different. He can do the same thing for you. Sometimes he does, but I got to be fair with you. Sometimes he doesn't. But stick around. That one's coming. This is one of those, wow, that wasn't near as bad as I thought it was going to be. Practical application, your garage. Cleaning your garage. Oh, there it is. You're thinking my garage was... Anybody here need to clean your garage? Raise your hand. Okay, excellent. Anybody here dreading that experience? Yeah. Julie and I did too. 10 years worth of junk. Not junk. It was quality when we put it in there, but, you know, it was junk. And finally this summer she said, let's just go in there and clean it. It'll take a day, but we'll just go in. And we go in. I mean, it was hot as blazes, and we moved all the junk out. This any good? No. It's amazing when you're cleaning it out how invaluable it becomes. And so we got it, and I looked at the garage, and I, this is beautiful. And it only took an hour. And I said, man, why did I wait 10 years to do this? And then I turned around, and there was a driveway full of junk. That's why I didn't do it. Now I got to rent a truck or borrow somebody's. I got to haul it someplace and go. And so Julie goes inside. She comes in out 5 minutes later. What did I say? Learn as much as you can. Act on what you learn and press on. She goes inside. She comes out. She says, I've got it covered. I said, what? She says, 1-800-GOT-JUNK will be here in an hour. I said, what is that? She says, it's a company that picks up our junk with a truck. Well, what part of the junk? Well, they said everything. Sure enough, they show up an hour later with their truck, and I got a driveway full of junk. I said, how much of that we all take? All of it. Really? You take that? Yeah. And that? Yeah. And these? Yeah. Hey, come in the backyard for a second. What about that and that and that and that? I said, yep, throw it on there. It was incredible. It was one of those, why did I wait 10 years? Maybe because 1-800-GOT-JUNK wasn't around 10 years ago, but it was one of those, now every day we go in. There's dread, there's fear, there's stuff that you just, relax. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Now, the third one, let me see where I'm at on my third fear. Afraid of doing a huge task. Anybody here ever been overwhelmed with the job you got? Maybe your company's merged. They just let everybody go except you. So now you got to do everybody else's work. Anybody had a major task? It's too much. If it hasn't happened to you, good for you. When it does, just remember this guy. I know you've never heard of him before, but he's a pretty cool dude. His name is Moses. His story is Exodus 2 and 3, when he's in front of the burning bush and God says, Moses, you're going to go deliver my people out of Egypt. And Moses immediately says, no, you got the wrong Moses. It ain't me. And he literally argues with God at the burning bush. Three times he protests and says, no, no, no. He says, they don't know me. That's all right. God says, I'm sending you. He said, well, who do I tell them sent me? I don't even know your name. And God says, my name is I Am. Tell them I Am sent you. Well, that'll go over big. Hey, leaders and slaves of Israel, of Egypt, I Am says hello. So he just says, that's not going to work, Lord. Then he says, they're not going to just open the door and let us go. And God says, I'll show you. I'll do signs and wonders. And then he starts saying, but I can't speak. And you can see God getting frustrated because Moses is just scared to death to take this task on. Finally, God says, boom, you're going to do it, pushes him out there, and the rest is history and movie cinematic history too. There are those tasks that we get asked to do. Trust God that if you are being asked to do it, then you probably have the skills, the heart, the knowledge, the passion, the experience to do the job. In your humility, you'll say, I don't think I can do this. But in God's power, you realize, like one of the verses, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And then the fourth one that we're always afraid of is getting rejected. Salespeople get paid more than anybody else per capita because they get told no more than everybody else per capita. Salespeople have a product and they got to listen to about 10 no's before they get a yes. Why do they make so much money? Because most of us, after one or two no's, we go, man, I'm not cut out for this, and we quit. But salespeople that stay with it work. Now, Jesus said, when you go into an area and you're scared of rejection. What if they don't like me? What if they don't accept me? What if it doesn't work out? Here's what Jesus said in Matthew 10. He said, when that happens, then shake the dust off your feet and move on. He didn't say, when you get rejected, feel sorry for yourself and moan and groan about how difficult life is. He said, shake the dust off your feet and move on. When you get rejected, he didn't say, whoa, you're one and done, that's it, you gave it a try, it didn't work, quit, this is God's way of saying, no, you don't have to persevere. No, he said, press on, shake the dust off your feet, and move on. If they don't like you, he says, go to the next town, and if they don't like you, go to the next one, the next one, and the next one, keep going. You say, wow, Jesus said all that? I thought that was my sales manager. Jesus said it before your sales manager did. When you go in, if they don't like you, don't get all bent out of shape. Just realize, you'll hear, nope, nope, nope. Hey, I told you, nope. I don't want to see you again. I'm going to put a restraining order. You better not show up again. I told you I don't want your product. No. And then, hey, you still selling that thing? I need that. You do? And a good salesman doesn't go in and say, man, you told me no 9 times. Good salesperson just goes in and says, press hard. There's 3 copies. A rejection comes, you get divorced, you get broken up with. There's all kinds of, some of you have gone through relationships that ended bad and you're scared to death to get in a new one. Stop that. Learn everything you can, act on what you learn, and press on through the journeys of life. Fear will make you stop. Fear is what kills the deer in the middle of the road in the car. You know, you're driving down the road and the deer sees your headlights and boom, that's it, you know. Boom, well, that's you. That's you and me. That's when we get, boom, and we get run over. We go, I knew it was going to hurt. It wouldn't if you had pressed on. It's the smart deer that don't ever wind up on the side of the road. Now, you learn a lesson, act on what you learn, and then you press on. Whether it works out good or bad, you keep on going through life. And the last fear I'll talk about is fear of pain and suffering. We all have that. You know, we're afraid of things either because it's unknown and we don't know what's going to happen, or we're afraid of the known. We've already experienced it and it hurt and we don't want to do it again. There's pain in life. There's pain throughout life. There's pain when you're born. There's pain when you're alive. When you get old, there's pain. That is a fact of life. You can fear it all you want, but it's rolling your way sooner or later. So how do we deal with pain? I'll tell you how I deal with it. I compartmentalize it and I compare it to other painful situations. And when I do that, mine doesn't seem to be nearly as bad as the others. My favorite guy is Paul, and it's 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 20 or 23 or 24. This is where Paul is writing the Corinthians, and he lists all of his pains for being a preacher of the gospel. Five different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. In all of my growing up, I didn't get 39 spankings from my mom, my dad, and my brother combined. He gets 39 lashes from angry men five times. If I'm preaching to you and you take me out and you whip me 39 times, I'm probably going to consider another area of ministry. I'm going to be a writer or a chaplain or something else. 39 times, and then he goes on. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent a whole night and a day at sea. Those of you that are thinking, wow, once I was stoned, yes, it's a good church. It's the other stoned, okay? It's the real one, not the one that you're thinking about. I know, it's 1 o'clock. It's the sleep in, sober up, let's go to church service. I got a rock, and I have several of them. Maybe you've heard it before, but I've got my rock, and it says TCBW. That's not yogurt. The yogurt is TCBY, the country's best yogurt. This is TCBW. Get you a nice rock like this and write TCBW on there and 2 Corinthians 11:24. So you'll go there and you'll remember it. Here's how it works. You're having the worst day of your life. You've been rejected, you've been fired, you've been divorced, you had your day in court and it didn't go your way. Something bad has happened to you and you're just, woe is me, nothing could ever hurt this bad. Maybe you started surgery, maybe you got a surgery and you're in recovery, but you're just thinking, I can't survive it. And then you grab your rock. Paul got stoned to death. Angry people, boom, they throw in these rocks, and it's probably a bad way to do that. If that had come out, that would have played bad, wouldn't it? It would have hurt. Maybe you'd have had the moment. But you know, boom, and he gets beat to death. And that's when he talks about it later. He says he was caught up to heaven and saw incredible things. But I guess the last thing was Jesus saying, nope, not your time. Down you go again. So there he comes. And he gets up and he dusts himself off and he keeps on preaching. You take your rock, TCBW, and that stands for things could be worse. And you tap your head three times with your rock. Gently now, not hard. And those of us that have banged our head more times than not, you'll remember that sound right there, that dunk. And you just tap your head and realize, you know, things could be worse. They could be pelting me with stones, beating me with rods, or whipping me with leather whips. It could be a whole lot worse. You go, wow, does that work? Every time I tap my head, I go, well, I'm not being stoned. So far, so good. I'll let you know when it doesn't. Pastor commits suicide, smashes his head on rock. Now, learn, act, and persevere. That's the process. Whether you're a preschooler trying to be not afraid of the dark, or a grown-up, or going into a marriage, or raising kids, or going off to college, it's the same principle. Learn all you can. Act on what you learn, and press on. It's a lifelong experience. 3 weeks ago, I had a creature outside of my back door. And it was a giant wasp. And it, I mean, it's like an inch and a half long, inch and three quarters long. You've probably seen him around. Let me show you that picture. There he is, right outside my back door. Anybody ever seen one of those? Yeah, they're all, you probably go home today, look around, you go, oh, they are there. Anyway, so 3 weeks ago, I'm going out with my coffee in the morning. And I open the back door and I walk out. And as I walk by this bush, this thing takes off and buzzes all around me, scares the coffee out of my cup. Other things too, but coffee out of the cup will suffice for the idea. But I mean, just, you know, the adrenaline kicks up because I've had bad reactions to bee stings in the past. And this thing's as big as I am. And the coffee's everywhere. And I go out, you know how that, when you get that adrenaline, you're just so wired. Oh, man. And I go back in and he's still there, still on the pavement, just hanging around. You know, and I did what you would do. I mean, I just walked around. Gosh, the thing is a monster. And then I go inside and I think, I'm going to kill him. Then I thought, what if somebody is videoing this and it goes viral? Pastor kills wasp. And the Lord put the idea in my mind, no, don't kill him, study him. Learn everything you can about him. I didn't even know what it was called. So I just Googled big wasp in South Texas. Sure enough, images, there they were. That's the one right there. And I'd look it up and he's called a cicada killer. Big giant cicadas that are out on your tree making all that noise. Well, these things come out, and the mother, the female, is bigger than the male. And, you know, so she, anyway, I won't give you all the story, but anyway, I learn about the cicada killer. And I learned from that, just learning all I could, that the one outside my door is a male cicada. I mean, a male cicada killer wasp. And they stake out their territory from now till about September, till the season is over. And he will attack anything that comes in the area. Other wasps, other cicada-killing wasps, if it's a male, I mean, they do just an incredible flight and just, it's out of there. And they will buzz around human beings too. And that's what he was doing to me. It's my house. I paid the taxes on it. He's freeloading. He's right outside my door. I mean, it could have been on the corner of the house where you never go, or in the garage where I won't be again for 10 years. There he is right outside my back door, and the Lord says, learn all you can about him. And I'm reading, and I'm reading. Yeah, that's him. That's a male. He's got his territory. He keeps going to the same spot. Yep, yep, yep. And then I'm reading, he will buzz around human beings, but never lands on them. You're kidding. Big old giant thing like that, he won't land on me? And then go on to find out, the male cicada killer wasp, he does not have a stinger. So even if he lands on me, about all he's going to do is crawl around and go, yeah, and fly away. No stinger. Now, if you see a really big one in the yard, that's a female, she has a stinger. A really big one. But these are the most docile of wasps, bees, and hornets. I am armed with knowledge now. This giant thing is camped outside my door. He's right in my line walking outside. But now I know he's not going to touch me, and he's not going to sting me because he doesn't have a stinger. And so this is what happens next. There he is. Yes, that's my foot. So you'll know how big he is and how brave I am. Now that I know he doesn't have a stinger, he's just going to buzz around and go back to his spot. Now I enjoy every morning. I go, hey, how you doing? Good to see you. Now instead of dancing around, we dance together, you know. Be back on the second cup. I'm scared to death somebody's going to visit my house and then come inside and go, oh, man, we just killed the biggest wasp outside your back door. No, that was my friend. He was my pet. He was the easiest pet I've ever had, and he's friendly, and he's nice, and he didn't hurt anybody. Now, that's just a fear. That's just one of a bunch of them. But that's the way it works. Most of the stuff we think is disastrous, it's going to ruin everything about us, you learn all you can about it, and you go, whoa, wait a second. That's not as scary as I thought. And you move forward with the knowledge you've got. And then you press on with life's journey. Eventually, you're going to go through all these fears until you hit the last one in life, which is the fear of dying. Research tells us in surveys that people would rather die than give a public speech. I'm not sure about that. Public speaking and dying, top two fears. Honestly, you would rather be dead than standing up here doing what I'm doing right now. Is that what you're saying? Public speaking isn't that bad. The red goes away once you get off the stage. The sweat dries up, the acid dissipates, the adrenaline also does whatever adrenaline does. But death, and that's coming. It's coming to all of us. Thief on the cross, there were two of them when Jesus was crucified. Both of them, not much happened to them, just took them out there, nailed them to the cross. The Roman plan was you get nailed to the cross, you stay there 3 or 4 days before you die. People look at you and talk about you and make fun of you, and you know, you're just an example of what happens when you defy Rome. But Jesus, the man in the middle, he was beaten nearly to death before he got crucified. He'd been whipped, he'd been punched, he'd been hit with sticks. He'd had it all. He was dying. And one of the thieves looks over and just starts cussing at him and making fun of him. Hey, if you're the Son of God, save yourself and save us too. You did all these miracles, signs, and wonders. We'll do something here. And he's just mouthing off to him. And the other thief looks over at his friend and says, don't you have any fear? He said, you and I, we deserve what we get. This man has done nothing wrong. And then he looks to Jesus and he says, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He knew he didn't deserve it. This man had done all kinds of evil. He was suffering justly for his sins. He's just talking to Jesus, and he says, Lord, remember me when you get into your kingdom. He didn't ask to get in. He said, put in a good word for me. He just said, remember me. And Jesus looked at him, and he said, today, I assure you, you will be with me in paradise in heaven. I assure you, you'll be with me. That guy wasn't supposed to die for another 4 or 5 days. So how could Jesus know? Because he's the Son of God. His words come true. And that night, all three of the men died. What I want you to know is that there is death coming to all of us. We all deserve it. We've all sinned against God. Pick whichever one that comes to your mind first. But any one sin you do is enough to say, you know what? Heaven's perfect. You're not. You can't get in. Well, I'm a good person. Yeah, good's great. But you're not perfect. You got to be perfect to get in. Perfect or forgiven. Since perfect is gone, go with forgiven. And then Jesus says, when you get to that point of death, it's the coolest thing to be with people that know they know Jesus when death comes. And it's that reality of this is it. But then they realize, wait a second, I know Jesus. And he said, I would never see death. Body stops, soul goes from here to heaven. Even scientists are starting to acknowledge there's something that goes on the other side of death. They don't know what it is, and they won't speculate because you can't scientifically test it, but there's so much evidence, so many near-death experiences, so many testimonies, totally unrelated, and they go, whoa, there's a big body of evidence that says something happens beyond what, you know, just dying. They won't speculate, and I don't expect them to. There's science. But Jesus said, I've overcome death. Whosoever believes in me will never perish, but will have everlasting life. That's the good news that he offers to a thief on the cross and to every soul in this room today. Some of you are at that point of death, or you're getting older, where that little extra pump of blood in your brain, you know, you go, is that a stroke? Is that an aneurysm? Is this it? Is this the one, Lord? And, you know, nothing happens. Your heart boom, hurts for a second. Oh, is this the big one? Is this the Widowmaker? No, it's heartburn. Oh. Your arm aches. Oh, they say aching arms. It's a heart attack? No, you did exercise yesterday. And so you keep going. You're a teenager driving. You're 16 and you're texting. And you nearly have an accident. Oh, that could have been it. Yes, it could. You're in an accident. Airbags go off. You live to talk about it. You go, wow, that was close. Life is filled with those things. Sooner or later, one of them's going to get you. Not me, but you. Just want to see if you're listening. Going to get all of us. To live is Christ. To die is gain. Now, if that's something you want, then I can tell you this. When you know Jesus, you overcome that fear of death because you know the one who overcame death. The Bible says it's not complicated. I mean, a thief on the cross can get it. You can too. It says the moment you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and you really believe that he was raised from the dead, because it's about the resurrection. If there's no resurrection of Jesus, then there's no life after death, there's no nothing. But if there is something after that, he's the only guy that has overcome it. The Bible says when you believe that and you confess with your mouth, Jesus, you are Lord of my life from this day on, that is your salvation. It's not joining a church. It's not a 13-week Bible study. It's not understanding all the verses in the Bible. But it's knowing you've sinned against God and the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of eternal life is yours through Jesus Christ, your Lord. If you want it, accept it today. I'm going to lead you in a prayer of salvation based on Romans 10:13. It says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So will you bow your heads with me and close your eyes? I'm going to ask you believers to say it out loud with me and anybody in this room. This may be your first time in church and you go, what am I about to do? I'm going to lead you in a prayer of salvation. If you want to accept Jesus' forgiveness, this is how you do it. You just pray this prayer and mean it. You mark this as the beginning of that new day. Let's say it together. Lord Jesus, today I trust you. I accept your forgiveness for all my sins. Fill me with your Spirit. Teach me from your word. Help me to overcome my fears. And thank you for my salvation.